Last time. Well, okay, first I found this trick. I was Googling number tricks, see if there's any more interesting ones out there. So here's one. You should be able to do it in your head. Shouldn't be any problems at all. Okay? So here's the first step.
One.
Don't have to say it. Keep it a secret. And five. I do not need anyone saying out loud what they're doing. Alright. And two. Please stop. Okay, subtract the number you started with. And you have seven. Bad. That's not a very good trick.
I think seven.
No, it's not.
Seven is especially not great. You pick a number, you add five, you add two. If you add five and then you add two, it's the same as doing what?
Adding seven.
Right? And you subtract the number you start with, you get seven. It is not intended to be a very good trick, right? It's kind of poking fun at those number tricks. And what you did in your head is what we're working on right now as an algebra class, and that is, you said the word expression, right?
Yes.
We're simplifying algebraic expressions, not equations, but expressions. That's what we're working on. And that's an important part of algebra. Being able to simplify those expressions, okay, is a key part of solving equations, understanding functions, all sorts of algebra stuff. Alright, so let's look at the expression that we came up with at the end of last class. And we'll work on simplifying it together. You can start us off?
So what I did first was I made x plus 5, the first x at the beginning.
This x?
X plus 5 minus x times 5. And
wait a minute. Why did you do that?
Well, I just forgot about it.
Why?
Because together of the x.
Which x? So you started with this. Right? And then you want to show me? I'm getting confused about it. So show me what you did. This x to this 5?
No.
Why not?
Because you don't want to add this.
Yeah, for a lot of reasons we can't add that x to that 5. For one, it's inside the parentheses. For two, it's inside another parentheses. Really, these parentheses are telling us, kind of reminding us that this x is part of the numerator of this fraction. Okay? So I cannot just take things out of parentheses and throw them around wherever I want to, okay? Gotta remember the order of operations. Gotta do things in the order that we talked about. If we don't, then we're not gonna get the same thing. Okay? If we can't follow the same order, then we have to put parentheses around every single thing. On top of that, this x is inside of this fraction, and to add this 5 to this fraction, I need what? To add a number to a fraction, we need to get upset. When we add a number to a fraction, what would we need?
We need to make that number to a fraction.
Okay, and then once it is a fraction, let's say we're adding x over 3 to 5. How do we turn this into a fraction?
5 over 1.
Over 1. Now what do we need?
We have to find the least common denominator.
Okay, then we need common denominators if we're going to add numbers, and well, numbers are fractions. Okay. If we're going to do that, we need to find a common denominator. You gotta be careful. That was doing a lot of stuff out of order, and also that fractions. Right?
So another idea?
Your question?
Okay. All right, another idea where to start. Something in this expression that you
can, and you can add the 3 as well.
This 3 right here, I can add it to the 12. Remember, order of operations, why wouldn't we add the 3 and the 12?
Because you have to do multiplying first.
Okay, let's multiply first.
You have to multiply that from x minus 1, and after you get that answer, you have to multiply it by 3.
So you have to do the x minus 1 before you multiply by 3. Okay, so we kind of have a thing here. Who thinks that there's nothing you can do because we don't have a number for x? All right. That's not correct. We can simplify this expression, even though we don't have a number to plug in for x, but I see what you mean, because I can't add x and negative 1. I can't take x and subtract 1 because x isn't a number. It's just like a placeholder for a number that we don't have yet. Okay. If I want to, the first thing that I need to do is multiply 3 by this number. Okay. And we can do that. With algebra, we can do that. Here, let me show you. If I want to multiply this by 3, I can just multiply 3 by x, and the 3 by negative 1, you get negative 3. Okay. Have you seen something like that before?
No.
Ever? What's that? It's the distributive property.
Yeah.
So you might have seen it a little bit before. Okay. Why is that the same as this?
Because when you timed a variable by a number, you could just put that number in front of the variable because, like,
well, hold on. My question is.
Yeah, I'm continuing.
Right.
It's the same because, like, with the x, it represents a number. It's kind of like if x was like 2, there would be 3 2s, and you would add those 2s together, so it would be 3 like x's, and then 3 times 1 is
3. Okay. This is what you're saying, but it doesn't quite explain why if I have an x minus 1, I can multiply the x by 3 and the 1 by 3 and call it the same thing. I'm going to figure out why this same as this. Why is it okay for me to just multiply both things by 3 and call it good? Yeah?
Because it's what the answer is for x minus 1 times 3, but if you just do both times 3, it's still the answer.
Taking a number, subtracting 1, and multiplying by 3 is the same as taking the number, 3 times the number, and subtracting 3 instead of subtracting 1, you're subtracting, and then multiplying by 3, you're subtracting 3 in the first place.
Yes.
Okay?
Isn't the reason you subtract 3 that we
Yeah. I mean, yes, so this makes sense. We're building up to something really, like, where I couldn't really say, like, but what about this? Daniela?
I think I figured out how to simplify it while you guys were talking about the 3x and the 93. And
we're still on that part. We're going to stay on the 3 times the x. Here is one way to see why this is the same thing. Grab it in here, so let's bring this up. 3 times x minus 1 plus 4.
3 times.
Times?
Times 3.
Oh, I put the 3 on the left.
Plus 12.
It did say it like this. Times 3 plus 12. Divide by 3 plus 5.
Yep,
minus
x.
Okay. So we're trying to, I want to show you why the first thing, because where a lot of you were, was you can't do anything because x is, what's x? I need to pick an x, then I can do these things. Okay? This thing called the distributive property allows us to simplify this expression, so then we don't have to do all this busy stuff. We can clean it up and see, you know, there's a simpler operation going on here. We don't have to do all this stuff. So, we're talking about multiplication. Yes?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
We're multiplying what by what? Not here, but up here.
3 by 1.
Just by one?
Or 3 times x minus 1.
Okay, 3 times x minus 1. Okay. And I just realized we have the subtraction. This is all the same thing. Let's say we were multiplying 3 by x plus 2. If I can show you for this, then it should be true for this as well. So here we're multiplying 3 by not x minus 1, but x plus 2. Okay? And I section it off because it's its own little thing. It's not exactly part of this. It's an example of the distributive property. Okay. So I'm going to use a rectangle to show you the distributive property. Alright? I'm going to use a rectangle to show multiplication. What about a rectangle can show multiplication? We've done it quite a few times. How many squares fit inside the rectangle? So that's called, where is that from?
Area.
The area of a rectangle can show us multiplication. Okay. So for instance, if I had a rectangle that was 3 on this side and 5 on this side, I could look at the perimeter, I could look at a lot of things. If I look at the area, I can see 3 times 5 because it shows me the number of squares. All good? Same page? Okay. But it's not 3 times 5. It's 3 times x plus 2. So I need to make this side, the base of the triangle or the rectangle, to be this. So I've got this being the height, and I'm going to make this be the base. Base times height. So let's say I call this much 2 and this much x. So we should think about that for a second. X. If x were 7, then how big would the whole base be? 14?
9.
Right. It'd be 7 from here to there?
Oh, then yeah, 9.
2. So 9. If the base, if x were 10, then how long would the base be?
12.
Okay, we're getting the idea. But x isn't just x. We're not putting a number in there. But if I did put a number there, how would I find the length of the base?
x plus 2.
Okay, so this side right here is x plus 2. If I just cut it off right there, then this part's x, this part's 2, this whole thing is the sum of x and 2. It's not 2 times x, and it's not x squared, and it's not anything special. It's x plus 2. So this side is in the side is x plus 2, and if I look at the area of the big rectangle, I'll see 3 times x plus 2. Right? The area would represent the product of 3 and the parentheses x plus 2. But with cutting it like this, how many rectangles do we have now?
Two
rectangles. So if we add up the two rectangles, we should get the big rectangle?
Yeah.
Okay. So what's the area of this guy here?
2 times 5 is 6.
6. 3 times 2 is 6, right? This side's 3 as well. So it's a rectangle. Okay. This is a rectangle. It's 3 and x on both sides. So what's that?
3x.
3 times x. Right? Right? X is just a placeholder. Once X comes along and tells us what it is, just multiply it by 3, we have the area of that rectangle, add it to 6, and we have the area of the whole thing. So we get 3x plus 6.
Wow.
Which is 3 times x and 3 times 2. Now that applies any time. Excuse me. This is really annoying to be here and annoyed by people who are talking. So if it works for 3 times x plus 2, it should work for 3 times parentheses x plus anything. So negative 1 would also work. So 3 times x is 3x, and 3 times negative 1 is negative 3. This picture is showing this thing called the distributed property. So by that little picture, we can see that it is totally allowed to distribute the 3 to the x to the negative 1. So after that, now we've handled the parentheses without actually being able to combine x and negative 1. Right? So what comes after that? What was the step after that multiplication?
Plus
12. All right, plus 12. This is going to be in my way. Divided by 3. Plus 5. Minus x. Okay, so that was like the first hurdle, but once we know about the distributive property, we get used to using it, and we want to simplify an algebraic expression. It's a really helpful thing to have in a normal tool belt. But now we're looking for more things we can simplify, numbers we can put together. What do you see, Clint?
Oh, you can go ahead and you can take negative 3 plus 12.
Negative 3 plus 12, yeah. Is that okay? I mean, you might think, well, we have to multiply 3 times x, right? Order of operations, multiplication before addition.
No, you can't do 3 times x.
And that multiplication piece is kind of like protected, right? Like, whenever x comes by and jumps in there, it'll get multiplied by 3 like it should in the order. Clint?
Yeah, but as long as you add up all the numbers, first, it doesn't matter.
You're right. It does not matter. So we get 9, right? Negative 3 plus 12 is 9. Over 3 is 5. X. Now what can we do?
Divide
3 and 9 by 3. So we get x plus 3 plus 5 minus x.
You add 3 and 5.
You get 8.
Plus
and
x. You add negative x and x.
Negative x and x is what? Add them together? Nothing, right? You can, sure you can imagine that that's true. If you put a 5 in there or 7, whatever, it's going to go away. What's left?
How did you get 12?
12 was
9. Sorry.
Not, oh, by negative 3 plus 12.
Oh, okay. I was looking at it from 3x minus 3 plus 12.
Well, it did come from there and then come down to be 9. Okay. Did I clear it up or did I confuse you?
Yeah, you just confused me at the start.
Okay, but you got it now? Okay, negative 3 plus 9. Or sorry, negative 3 plus 9. And what's left now?
8.
Eight.
Yeah.
Question?
Did that 3, or there now on the third level, there's x plus 3 plus 5 minus x?
Mm-hmm.
Where'd the 3x go?
That was 3x plus 12. We divided 3x by 3.
Oh, okay.
So a third of that is just one of the x's.
One.
And then 9 divided by 3 is 3.
Oh, okay.
Okay? So we divide it by 3. We follow the order of operations, but we said, well, x kind of needs to, it's going to be multiplied by something, we're just going to kind of have to set that aside and do that when it comes along. But hey, I can add these things together, right?
Yeah.
And that would be, that order would be fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
So when we simplify using algebra, we see that all this stuff, up until here, subtracting 1, tripling, adding 12, dividing by 3, and adding 5 all turns out to be the same as doing what?
Adding
8.
Subtracting
9. That's what I was thinking. Like adding 8. Right?
And then subtracting the number you started with.
Well, I put a line there, right, just before that. So all of this stuff, all that stuff that we did, it's the same as taking your number and just adding 8. Okay? And then what do we do? We subtract the number that we started with and we're left with?
8,
right? When I look at it like this, it's not a very good trick. If I just have a trick like this, it's not very tricky, right? It's all this extra stuff that makes it seem like a trick, seem like magic, but it's not really.
It's math.
I also tried replacing the bar again with a number, and I also get 8.
True. But what you do when you plug a number in there is you only do the trick for that one number. Using algebra, we just did those steps to every number imaginable. You see the difference?
Yeah.
So, I mean, yeah, it should work, should get 8, and that proves that the like parentheses are in the right place and all that kind of stuff. But allowing it to stay x proves it for every number in the universe, yeah?
How did the birthday magic trick work?
Okay, that was something that other class was doing as well. Let me see if I can find it. Oh, it's a part of the number.
So you have to click on number 139.
Oh, there it is. Okay. Clear this off so we can get that together. Okay? So, we'll do the same thing. We'll use algebra to explain exactly why this works, and it's not that amazing once you clean up the algebra. So, first we need to start with a number 2 to 9, right? How do we show that with algebra?
Variable.
Variable. What do you want to use?
X.
X is good. It's classic. X. Okay, and then double it. How do we show doubling it?
X2, so 2x.
And then add 5. Now multiply like all of this by 50, right? So I can't just do this.
Parentheses,
very good. Then, okay, we're going to kind of have to decide to be one person or the other. Okay? So let's pretend to be somebody who's had the birthday already. So we'll add 1765, not 4. Okay, and then we. What's that?
2002.
Okay, we'll use 2002. So you were born in 2002, I assume, and you had your birthday?
Yeah.
That'll work, and that's it. Now we're going to use algebra to clean it all up. Using what we just learned, what's one thing you could do, yeah?
50 times 5.
Just 5?
5, or 2x plus 5.
Right, so what is that property?
Distributive.
The distributive property. 50 times 2 is a... what?
100x.
Right, and 50 times 5?
250
plus 1765 minus 2002.
Right.
Now what?
1765 minus 2002.
Now you could do that. That would be 100% correct. I'm going to suggest, though, that we add 250 and 1765 and see what happens. Just so that the magic is no longer magic. So what do we get when we add those two?
2015.
Now why does that sound familiar? What is this?
The year of?
The year of now. And if I subtract 2002, if that's the year I was born, what's 2015 minus the year I was born? Give me. 13, or you know, how old I am, right? So there's the age part, right? That's where the age comes from.
So if this was made like last year, it wouldn't work.
Right. And actually, I found this one on a website as well, and it was a few years old, and when I did it, it came out and said I was 29. Okay? That's not how old I am. So I just had to adjust that 1765, 1764 number so that it works for this year. And when I first did this trick, like when I found it, that one sounds interesting, and I wrote it down and did it, I wasn't sure what was going on, but they used algebra and everything that's going on all fell out. Okay?
So after this next step, so obviously 2015
minus 2002 equals 13. Right, that's a solid age.
So what would we do with the 100x?
Well, here, let's think about what happens. Like, remember the last number that we get is our number, and then two digits are the two digits that are the age.
Okay.
So our number winds up being here. This is a three-digit number, right? It's whatever 113. So how does our number always wind up being here?
Well, because you're times it by basically 1 and then adding 2 zeros.
Yeah, like that's a little shortcut for multiplying by 100, right? You just put zeros, 2 zeros at the end of it. I don't want to do all the work of the algorithm. I remember every time I multiply by 100, just 2 zeros get tacked on. So now what I wind up with is my number 0, 0, okay? Kind of bad notation. I'm not saying x times 0. I'm saying my number and then 2 zeros. And then when you add an age, what kind of a number is an age?
13.
So what?
2 digits.
2 digits, right? Not 3 digits, or I guess it could be 1 digit, but I think a lot of 1 digit age people are doing this. So we have now 2 digits, that's the age right there, and since we put the 2 zeros there, we just kind of cleared out space, no interference when we add that 2 digit age, right? So that doesn't cause any carrying over to the hundreds place, it just slips right in there. So there you go, there's the secret behind the age trick as well.
Cool.
I think so. But, you know, I'm a math teacher. It's neat because it is difficult to figure out what's going on there. With that other trick with the, you know, little troll face, that was really obvious. That 5 plus 2 is 7, and when I subtract the number 7, there's not a lot of smoke and mirrors, not very impressive. This is hard to see, but when we use algebra, we can clean it all up and see exactly what's going on. And I bet you that somebody sat down and said, hey, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to have them take their number, multiply it by 100, and then take their age and add it in. Right? Not a good trick. How they get you to calculate your age, instead of just saying, oh, put your age in there, right? They make you calculate it by taking your birth year away from the current year. Still not very good. So what do? They say, well, 100 has 50 as a factor, right? Well, 2015 or whatever year it is when you write this trick, well, I may not have a factor of 50 in it. 2015 doesn't have a factor of 50 in it. So we'll break it apart. We'll pull a number over here that does have a factor of 50, right, kind of a big one. And the cool thing that happens with that is you get this seemingly random number that you just add in. Where did that number come from? And then, well, instead of saying multiply your number by 100, because that, you know, Grace might see through that, she says, well, you just put 2 zeros on there. Let's make it a little trickier. Instead of multiplying by 100 all at once, multiply by 2, and add 250, and multiply by 50, and that'll be the same as multiplying by 100, right? And just add 250. So we just kind of put stuff together and make these steps a little more complicated and disguise something pretty obviously that would be your number plus your age slipped in there. Now, what person would this not work for, though?
Someone who's not the ages that you have to be for this.
What ages would those be?
It'd be the range from 12 to 0 and from 15 and up.
12? 12
yeah.
Wouldn't work? Yeah.
Well, because you're only using 1765 and 1764.
Right, but that is that part that calculates the ages the year you were born, right? So if I change the year I was born, then it's 2015 minus 2000 or whatever year I was born, should always just give me my age. Even if I'm 12 or 11 or 10, it should always just figure out my ages, right?
It would be like 1 through 9, because then you would just gotten, if you were 8, you would just gotten
18. Well, not 80, but 8, right? Like, when you do this part, this is your age, right? So you'll get, you know, somebody who was 8 was born in 2007.
7.
Thank you. 7, okay? So that comes out to be 8, right, not 13. So this number would be x, whatever your number was, 0, 8. It still kind of works. People don't usually say, I'm 0, 8 years old. But it still kind of works, yeah?
If you were 100
or more. 100 or more, yeah. Then I have a 3-digit age. What's that?
No.
Then I have a 3-digit age, and now I'm messing up the x there. Is there a fix for that if you know the person you're talking to is over 100? Who
Yeah.
How do you fix it?
I don't know, sir.
Yeah?
You need time to buy 500.
By 500 here instead of 50?
Yeah.
Yeah, you move the thing over to the thousands digit instead of just 500. Neat. Okay. Very good. Alright, so that's expressions. What we're gonna work on, and probably we don't have enough time to do the whole thing. We're gonna get started on it. We're gonna talk about functions. Okay, we're gonna talk about expressions. Just these things with x's or a's or whatever, and then we clean them all up and make them a much simpler calculation. Okay, it's much easier to multiply a number by x and add your age. Done. Than to do all that other stuff. And that's the idea behind simplifying an expression. Let's make it an easier calculation than what it is currently. But to start with functions. Oh, that's something else. There we go. Oh, that's that birthday card. Back to your triangle. So make sure you got your triangle. And play a little video for you for a couple of reasons.
So I thought that was very interesting. And I do not know why they don't tell you this at school. Because it makes a lot of sense. It only takes a second, really. And it really helps you understand about the angles of the triangles and how they all fit together. And, you know, this, I think this should be taught in schools because it really helped me. And I can't believe that I didn't know this until sophomore year of college. So I hope you enjoy, and I hope if you didn't know this already, that you understand now. And because I know this really helped me. So thanks for watching.
Okay, so for one thing, I wanted you to see what we're going to do with our triangles. And another, I just wanted you to hear what she had to say about it. She said, this should be taught in schools. It's just a student, it's her opinion. She found it useful, found it helpful. Okay? Just to show you, like, there's human beings out there who agree with what I'm saying, in that instead of just telling you what the angles of a triangle add up to, we're going to see that the angles of a triangle add up to a certain thing. So we're just, and I would recommend not using your scissors because people last class got very mixed up between their triangle angles and the ones that got made from cutting it. So I would suggest ripping it like she has. And maybe putting, you might not be able to tell, there's dots there, dot there, dot there. So she can keep track of which ones are the from her triangle. So what we're going to do is cut it up, and in the last class needed me to show them. So I will do that. So we have scissors. These, I'm going to cut a triangle out of my paper here. Okay. So all we're wanting to do is take these angles and put them next to each other, but they're in a triangle, so they're hard to do that with. So we're just going to tear them up, right? I'm going to put this angle here with this angle. And I want this one to go right there, so I need to tear it off. So that goes there. This is from that other angle. And just put them together, right? That's all I want you to do. Go ahead and do it. We're going to run this experiment many times because there's many triangles in here.
How much pieces do you want us to rip this into?
It should just take three, right? You want to put the three angles next to each other. See what happens there along the top.
Oops.
What kind of shape am I getting here along the top?
A straight line.
Yeah, not really a shape, but it's a straight line. Okay. So what you want to be able to do is take your triangle and take all three angles and just put them together like this, and that just requires tearing your triangle up. Okay. Yeah. How's that going? Triangles. So you got this angle, this angle, this angle. They all be together, so you see, you basically see like what this angle plus this other angle plus this other angle would be. Right? But to get this angle down there, you just tear it and put it there. Good. three dots together.
Oh, good on three. Oh, but it doesn't fit though.
Maybe it doesn't fit.
This doesn't fit on here.
Oh, that's not important. What's important is when I see all of these three angles from the triangle together, if I go from here to there, how big an angle is that?
Oh, 180.
180. Now, is anybody not getting 180? We put all those angles next together, we add them all up. Who's getting 180? Alright. We're all getting 180. Nobody's not getting 180. The thing about that is not completely mathematical is those are just several examples. We have 13 examples, 14 with mine, 15 with hers, right? But how many triangles are there?
Gazillions.
Precisely gazillions. Okay? So what we need to do is show that that is always going to happen for all of triangles. Okay? So we're going to do something that shows, like every step we go, I'm going to say, can we do that with every triangle, with any triangle at all? And you'll say, well, either yes or no.
Yes.
Either you'll believe me or you won't. You should be skeptical. You should not believe me until I can prove that it works. We're all too trusting most often. Okay.
Well,
too much sometimes. In a math class, you should be very skeptical. If I tell you the distributive property works,
you should make me prove it,
which I have. Anyway, here we are, a triangle. Okay? If we add up the angles of the triangle, this one, and this one, and this one, it should all add up to what?
180.
Okay. So we're going to prove that to ourselves. First, I'm going to group these, I'm going to copy. Copying a shape. So common. So. First, we're just going to put it right next to that one. Okay. And you copy it again? Have you seen this before?
Oh,
well,
I know where you're
going. I know where this is going.
Take this. So can I put a copy of a triangle right next to itself, no matter what the triangle is?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, flip it upside down. Will this fit right in here?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
So
well, we know, we just slid a copy of it straight over, straight line, right? Well, do we see all three angles here?
Yep.
Yeah. Blue, red, green. They all add up to what?
Well, 180.
Okay? Pretty convincing proof. Let me show you one more proof. It hurts to have another one. Okay? I'm going to draw a line that's parallel to this line, which means it's, I'm going to use this line on the line of paper, okay? This line right here. All right. Then I'm going to extend these sides like this. All right. How big is this angle?
It's the same as the other one.
The same as this red one?
Yeah.
Okay. The same as that one. If I think about this line here, right, and this line here, how about this angle right here? It's the same as what other angle?
Green.
Who thinks red? Who thinks blue?
Blue.
Who thinks green?
I think both.
Think about it this way.
Oh,
think about this blue angle just blue. Sliding along and going right there. The same?
Yep.
Just slide, this is flat, this is flat. Just slides along here. Fits right there. So this one, up here, fits right there. It's on a straight line, again, 180. Down. So all the angles in a triangle add up to what? All right, we've seen it. We've done it with our pieces of paper. We've seen it as a proof. What I want you to do is for these three shapes, which is just the next number of sides, four sides, five sides, and six sides, figure out what the sum of the angles is. Now I'm going to give you a hint, and it's going to use what you just learned. Right? Let's say I look at this shape, four-sided figure. It's hard to say, but if I start here, and I draw a line to another vertex, like, can I draw it to this one? I mean, it doesn't really do it, just redraw that line. But if I draw it over to this one, I won't draw it because it'll be almost a dead giveaway. That's what I want you to do. For a four, five, and six-sided, find the sum of the angles inside of it.
Homework?
Yeah.
Four, five.
Not just the sum of it.
So for a four-sided, a five-sided, a six-sided, it doesn't have to be a square. It could be anything with four sides. And the hint, remember the hint? Don't forget the hint. It's pretty key. If I draw this from there to there, I should be able to use what we just did in the page before this.